The thought of being snatched away and held against your will is positively terrifying. And unfortunately, kidnapping isn't just an element of horror stories, but a grim and brutal reality. Here are three true and terrifying stories from brave individuals who escaped their would-be kidnappers. About 2 years ago, I was 19. It was around 9 in the morning, broad daylight, and I was walking about a half mile to work from my bus stop. The street I was walking on was super busy with other commuters driving to work, so I really had no reason to expect anything out of the ordinary to happen. That's when this crappy, beat-up Toyota drove up and was following me super slow. He started yelling at me and saying things like, "Hey, sexy lady, get in my car!" I tried to ignore him, but he wasn't going away, so I finally lost my temper and told him to screw off. This caused him to speed off and pull into an alleyway ahead of me. I figured that that was the end of it, but I had my phone ready just in case. When I got close to the alley, the guy popped out and grabbed my coat and tried to drag me into his car. I managed to push him away, ripping my coat in the process, and ran like hell towards my work. With my hands shaking, I called 911, and the guy, he was back in his car and following me again. I was able to see his license plate number and gave it to the operator. I tried my best to explain what was happening, and they stayed on the line with me until I got to my office. Through all of this, that man was still following me, screaming insults from out his car window. The cops did eventually come by and arrest him, and he was charged with kidnapping in the second degree. But unfortunately, he was found not guilty because they had, and I quote, "no solid evidence that anything occurred other than my word." Then, the cops took it one step further and blamed me for the way I was dressed. Apparently, business casual khakis, a button-up shirt, and a pea coat are just scandalous. And they also raised questions about where I work, Planned Parenthood, and said that he probably thought I was a prostitute and was trying to pick me up. The screwed up thing? He was arrested for raping and beating a woman a few years ago, yet he's still on the loose. I guess what I'm trying to say is, watch your back. If this can happen in the middle of downtown during business hours, it can happen anywhere. When I was 7, my friend, who we'll call Dan, had just turned 8 a few days before. It was the summer of 1988, and Dan and I were playing basketball at the local park with a new basketball he had just gotten from his parents. The basketball court at our park was on the back corner and was backed up against the street and a fenced-in field. This location kept it out of view to the rest of the park due to the hills between it and the rest of the place. While playing, a maroon Buick Regal from the late 70s pulled up and three guys got out of the car. We didn't pay much attention to them because it was a public park, and we were used to older guys coming and taking over the basketball courts, considering we could barely throw the ball high enough to make a shot. One of the guys walked around to the back of the court and stood in the back entrance, and then one of the other two guys came into the court as the other guy stood at the front entrance. We continued to ignore them and played basketball on our own half of the court. The guy that came in took the ball and said we were going to come with him. At this, we freaked out and started trying to run to the other side of the court. He caught Dan and took him over to one of his buddies. Then he threw the ball and hit me in the back, knocking me over. He picked me up and they put us in the back seat of the truck. We couldn't jump out because two of the guys were sitting back there with us. We were screaming and yelling, but no one was around at 11 a.m. that day. They drove about 10 miles north of the city limits to an old dirt road, then drove another 3, maybe 4 miles down that dusty road to an old two-story house. It had one of those old basements with bulkhead doors. They literally threw us down there and locked the doors on us. It was dark and smelled like something had died. We heard them drive off. Fortunately, Dan had one of those squeeze lights that looked kind of like a lighter that he had bought earlier that morning when we were at a convenience store. In the dim light, we looked around the room a bit, and there was a bunch of canning stuff down there. We tried to push the door open, but had no luck. The day went along, and we were stuck. It never entered my mind at the time that we could be in serious danger. In fact, the only thing my stupid 7-year-old brain was worried about was getting in trouble if I didn't come home in time. Well, evening came, and we heard another vehicle drive up. Then, we heard that truck join as well. We could hear the guys and someone else yelling out in the yard. Then, the door to the house slammed. We could hear people walking around the wooden-floored house. The sun went down, and we began to really freak out. It was hard because we knew that if we yelled like we wanted to, the guys who brought us here would come and get us, and that could be worse than just being left alone. The flashlight was about dead from an entire day's worth of use, but we had found a phone jack that had been run down, and we also found a broken old phone. We crossed our fingers and plugged it in, and we got a dial tone. However, we couldn't dial out. Dan remembered watching a MacGyver episode earlier, and they called 911 by using hanging up the phone in a sequence of 9 short times, then a pause, then another short click, followed by a pause, and then another short beep. We tried and tried and nothing happened. It took us about an hour until we finally managed to get it to work, and the police answered. By that point, we were in a full-blown panic. However, we managed to hold it together enough to describe what direction they had taken us in and anything else we could remember. Afterward, they said they were on their way, but we needed to try and hide and wait. And sure enough, within about 20 minutes, we heard faint sirens in the distance, and they sounded like they were getting closer. A few more minutes passed, and sure enough, we heard the rumble of tires sliding across gravel. Suddenly, there was a thundering of footsteps on the wooden floor above us. We began to panic, not sure who would find us first. Before we could even react, the basement door slammed open. We recoiled in fear, but then nothing happened. We slowly opened our eyes to see the brightest light shining down on us and a friendly officer climbing down into the basement. And just like that, the ordeal was over. I can still smell that foul, rotting stench of the basement to this day. A part of me can't help but wonder if that smell was from somebody else they might have kidnapped before us, who wasn't as lucky. As a little kid, I didn't really comprehend what was happening, but now, as an adult, looking back chills me to the bone. In September 1992, I was finishing my last weekend working at a convenience store and had just locked the doors about 15 minutes past midnight. This was my last weekend because I was a substitute teacher for the school district and the store was only my summer job. I had bought some snacks before closing, tucked my purse under my arm, and went to open the front door of my car, which was parked almost right in front of the store. It was as I was about to get in that I saw him, coming out of the back seat of my own car. I flung myself backward and screamed at the top of my lungs while I ran. In literally 3 seconds, he had me on the ground with his thumb in my throat. He said, "I could kill you right now and think nothing of it." It was at this moment that another vehicle pulled into the parking lot. This got him off of me for a moment as he charged after it, chasing off the woman who was driving it. While he was distracted, I got up and ran, but he caught up with me halfway across the street and pulled me up by my hair. I began to sob, and he just said, "Don't cry," in a rough voice. Terrified though I was, I managed to suck it up and tried to assess my situation. I still had my keys in my hand, and I thought maybe I could poke him in the eye, but he was pretty strong and that might just make it worse. Before I could do anything else, he started questioning me. He asked if I was married, and I said no. Then he asked me if I had any children, and I don't, so again I said no. Despite having answered honestly, he seemed to not believe me. He shook me and said, "Don't you lie to me." By this point, we had walked about 3 to 4 blocks to where his car was, and he opened the passenger side door to let me in. Immediately, all the movies I had watched as a teen came back to me, and I had to put my thoughts about, "I'd have done this," or "I'd have done that," if I was in that situation, to work in reality. Of course, no lock button on the passenger side. As I got in, I looked down, and I saw it, a cigarette lighter. Trying not to draw too much attention to my plan, I asked if I could possibly light a cigarette, and to my surprise, he obliged me. Quickly, I grabbed the lighter and began heating it up. I then grabbed a cigarette and lit it, but I didn't drop the lighter. Slyly, I rolled down the window a bit, under the illusion of needing to let the smoke out. To get to the main highway, we had to pass right back in front of the store again, but this time the police had already been called there. That's when I took the opportunity to start screaming out the open window. At this, he backhanded me, and then I just lost it. In a mixture of fear and rage, I dug the red-hot lighter into his face. In his moment of pain and disorientation, I managed to unlock my door from his side, as well as yank the keys from the ignition. The car began to slow, and I took the opportunity to leap from the door. Fortunately, I landed safely, and the police caught him just a short way further. He was successfully charged and sentenced with 24 years in prison, but the event still haunts me. I don't like to think about what could have happened if I hadn't been so lucky.